Okay, we are recording on all platforms. Welcome back, everybody. This is yours truly. You're the Hungover Hermit. For those of you on any platform listening to this besides YouTube, go follow my YouTube account, Hungover Hermit. I have extra content over there. Also, you guys probably don't know that I've had a technical difficulty on what was supposed to be episode 2. So now this is going to be episode 2, I guess. Fuck it. On YouTube, you got a special 1.5 as well as some other content I've been working on over there. But for those of you here exclusively for the podcast, we're going to jump right into it. And we're going to start with my drink of the day. Today, I'm just, it's nothing crazy. I just have some Bud Ice. Just some beer, you know. Listen, I didn't get to the liquor store before it closed. That was my fault. I hopefully have something from my next recording. Something stronger. I like getting drunk talking with you guys. Man, I took a sip without saying cheers. So, belated cheers. And cheers again. So on that note, today's episode is going to be a little different. We're going to be talking about different types of conspiracy theories. And now I've selected 5 different ones that I'm going to speak about. And I'm going to break them down into 3 different categories. Ones that I think are highly possible. So we're going to call those possible. We're going to call ones that could go either way. Plausible or unlikely, and then we just have a couple that are just, I'm just gonna be like, no, that's bullshit, I don't believe it. And yeah, let's jump right in. So I'm gonna start off right away. Moon landing hoax. So was the moon landing a hoax? I'm just start off and tell you no. I do know, I have heard a lot of the ideas behind why it could be a hoax, like, and the whole Cold War situation that was going on at the time, and the fact that the United States was trying to beat Russia into space. But the thing is, if we were going to do it as a hoax, why didn't we beat their satellites? Obviously, now today we have satellites in the sky. With the moment, I know some of the other things say, like, oh, in the pictures, we don't see any stars. I mean, the moon landing happened in 1969. Do you really think we had great photography back then that could pick up the smallest piece of light in space, which is basically other than a few specks of light, mostly dark? It's space. It's not... It's called that for a reason. It's not crowded up there. It's not like you see everything close up. Everything is a long ways away. And 1969 photography, I'm just telling you right now, they weren't using no digital cameras. The phone you use probably has a better camera than any camera that existed back then. So I'm just put that straight out. Yeah, no. People claim, like, oh, the flag was moving. Again, something you need to understand about space. Yes, there is no air, so there would be no wind blow. But also, there is no friction. When you put... Air causes friction. If you put no friction on an object and it starts moving, obviously they had to pick up this flag and put it there. So they caused the movement. And the movement isn't going to stop unless a force stops it. Plain and simple. So for all those people out there that really think that, like, this was faked, I mean, I feel, other than the whole trying to show off to the Soviet Union thing, there really is no other reason to fake that. Like, logically, there's really no other reason to fake that. I guess you could try to show off to your public, but at the time, I feel like what mattered more was, hey, who has more nukes than the other country? We don't need to go into who got somewhere. The moon isn't even that far. Remember, we're a species, we haven't even landed a man on Mars yet. Although, there's another conspiracy theory about that. But I'm not getting into that one, because I don't even feel like that one's worth my time. So, was the moon landing a hoax? Long story short, no. Just no. Because I feel like it's more like people failing to understand how photography works and how physics in space works. Those are the main two arguments I've heard. And I know people said something about like astronauts coming out. I mean, I don't know. Everybody at a certain point tries to say something for attention, I feel like, sometimes. So if it's like one out of a whole team, do you really, you're really going to just call them automatically the whistleblower? Or are you going to call them a clout chaser? They didn't even have that term back then, but that's how I look at it. You wanted attention, you tried to say something, you realize that's not going to work, and then you try, and then people are like, oh, the government's trying to silence him. No, he just realized he came off like an idiot. Okay, I'm going to call it like it is. This is what we do over here. We call it like it is. We're not going to pussyfoot around everything and pretend that things are true when they're not. It's not worth our time to waste our time doing that. And even at the end of the day, I would just say this. Whether the moon landing was hoaxed or not, which is a big if, but even if it was, what does that change for us? On our day-to-day life, what does that change? Why do we care? We have no real reason to. So, I feel like there's nothing to gain significantly in the long term from keeping up that hoax and funding NASA as big as we do. It would just be pointless and a bigger cost than it's worth in the end of the day. So for all logistical purposes, I'm going to just straight up say this is a no. Because it makes no sense to do it like that. Now, before we get on to our next one, give me a second. I'm going to finish my beer and I'm going to pop my next one. And we will be back in 1 second. Thank you. Okay. Now that I have my new beer, forgive me while I light my cigarette for a second. Don't smoke, people, but I do. It's my personal choice. I like to enjoy my life, even if it means it's a little shorter. Hey, I've lived a good life. I don't mind. So the next one we're going to get into is basically aliens being the elite. We also know like the reptilians that people try to claim are shapeshifters and have taken over the elite of our country. Now, this one is really not even going to take me that long. Because I 100% believe in aliens in general, yes. In an alien elite of our world, no. No. And I'm going to tell you why in a couple quick statements, basically. First being, if any alien race has the capability of reaching our planet from another solar system or another galaxy, their technology surpasses ours so much that trying to corrupt us from the inside is kind of pointless. Excuse me. For everything they're capable of, they can wipe us out easily. Easily. Our weapons would probably barely harm them compared to whatever type of technology they have. I mean, our strongest weapons to this day are still basically nuclear, and we came up with that during the Second World War. Yeah, we've improved on it, but the point is, compared to them, we would be primitive. And second, is that I think the whole idea of it is really an excuse for people not to want to blame themselves, as the human race. I mean, like, that you don't want to think that other humans are capable of doing all the crap and putting us through all the crap that we go through. But let's be honest, there is an elite in the world that I 100% agree with. Is it controlled by aliens? No. It's controlled by greedy, narcissistic people that want to control everybody else. It has nothing to do with aliens. Humans are inherently greedy. It really doesn't have to be explained any deeper than that. At least I don't feel, because I just feel like the whole reptilian shapeshifter is just a way of people trying to hate on somebody that they don't like, that's in power, and they don't like the system. So you blame aliens instead of realizing that these are other people and actually doing something about it. You're blaming something that you can't prove or seem to do anything about, but these are real people that we can fight them. We can do something. We can make the change. That is 100% possible. So, that, I just feel like it's just so unlikely. I have to give that a no. I have to give that a bullshit. And I know that I'm summing this one up really quick, but honestly, both statements basically say it all. First of all, if there were aliens that were reaching us and wanted to do anything with us, besides observe us as a science experiment, which if they have reached us, that's probably the most they're doing. Using us for science experiments the same way we use all the animals we consider inferior on our planet. They will consider us inferior too. Therefore, they would use us for that, but if they wanted Earth, if they wanted to conquer us, their technology would just allow them to. Their knowledge, their technology, everything, it would make the strongest nations in this world realize how insignificant they are on the scope of the universe. We're a small blue speck. We think the Earth is big, but we're a small planet in our solar system. Jupiter is bigger than us. Saturn is bigger than us. I think like half the planets in our solar system, if not more, are bigger than us. And that's just in our solar system. That's the point. We haven't even got a man on Mars. I said this in the last one. It was like, but basically it was like, it's just like, there's no point. There is no point. Our technology is so insignificant that any alien species that would be able to cross galaxies, they would look at us like we look at a cockroach. If they chose to, they can stomp on us and wipe us out completely. They're not going to be here trying to control us from the inside, because what do they have to gain from that? But people have a lot to gain from that. And why not let the conspiracy continue? Because now, instead of blaming a person, you're basically putting the blame on something that you can't do anything about. So keeping that conspiracy alive and not even trying to dismiss it works in the favor of every human in power. And if people can't realize that type of thing is what divides us from standing up to the corruption done by other people and the bad done by other people. We blame it on something we can't do anything about, and therefore that's our excuse to sit back and do nothing and just talk about it. So it's a good conspiracy to keep alive in the end of the day. And it doesn't even take that much to keep a conspiracy alive. Because if you say nothing, people keep on talking about it. If you try to fight it, oh, we're right, and now the government's trying to cover it up. That's how conspiracies work. I'm not saying they're all untrue. And trust me, I have a few on here. I have a couple on here that I think are true. But the key element in the end of the day is who has something to gain from this conspiracy and why. Would an alien race have anything to gain from this conspiracy? No. But with an average day human have something to gain from the public believing they're more than average, that they're supernatural in a way, that they have advanced technology? Of course they have something to gain. You're making them seem even more powerful than they already are. And that's exactly what they want, is to seem powerful and have control. So yeah, I'm gonna just call that one a hard no. It's bullshit. Okay? Feel free to disagree with me. You guys on YouTube, you can post in the comments. For everybody else, this girl needs to stop texting me. Okay, shut up. I need to put my phone on silent. I'm gonna fight somebody. I'm gonna fight somebody for messing up my recording. But we're gonna leave all that in there, and I'm gonna act like that never happened. And I'm gonna pause for a second while I put my phone on silent, make sure no other notifications pop up and disturb my recording. And we will be right back in 1 second with the third conspiracy we are covering today. Be right back, everybody. Okay, so on that note, where the hell are my cigarettes? Yeah, let me get this ready. I'll say where they are with them in my hand. I don't even know what I'm saying. Let's go. Okay, so I'm sorry, everybody. I'm sorry. I know that probably came up on the recording when my phone went off. Apparently, it's truly the Hungover Hermit is a popular guy, even at 4 o'clock in the morning. But I gotta put work first. I gotta put work first right now. It's like 4 in the morning, but the grind doesn't stop. I gotta keep on working. So let's speed this up. Let's go right ahead into our third conspiracy we are gonna cover today, and that is gonna be the JFK assassination. Now, for those of you who don't know, the conspiracy is that whoever was the guy that was arrested for the JFK assassination was a fall guy. I mean, there's a lot of information behind that, considering the shot he took. Apparently, he had been trained somewhat in the military, and he was actually a very poor marksman, so a lot of people believe there was no way he could have made that shot. So just for starters, they were just calling it out, like, based on skill, there's no way this guy was the one that would have done it. Now, I'm just going to go into, again, a reason behind it. Because before you dissect any type of conspiracy, you need to figure out if there's a reason for anyone to cover up information behind it. And in this, the most blatant reason is from a speech, that JFK had. It definitely was like less than a week or a few days before his assassination. I don't remember the exact dates off the top of my head. I'm sorry, I'm not good at memorizing dates. But in a speech, he said there is a conspiracy in this country to control every single man, woman, and child. And I plan to expose that conspiracy. Now, think about that quote for a second. A conspiracy to control every man, woman, and child, and he wants to expose it. Do you really think that something that whoever was running this, that plan would want him to expose? Of course not. So therefore, getting him out the way, oh yeah, we have a big reason for that. So just some disgruntled ex-military nobody that is supposed to have been basically working independently. No, that's not it. That's not it at all. And for those of you who don't know a little deeper, JFK wanted to return our country to something that we had before the Great Depression. Before the Great Depression, we had what was called a gold reserve. Basically, our money, we could take it to the bank and get equal value of pure gold for whatever money if we wanted. Now, after the Great Depression, that was basically one of the biggest starters of the Federal Reserve. Now, for those of you who don't know, the Federal Reserve is not federally owned. It is a private bank. Just like companies like Federal Express, it just puts the word federal in front of its name to make itself sound more legitimate and more trustworthy, because people on average seem to trust their government at least more than they trust a random company. So now, who owns the Federal Reserve? Well, that goes back to something that was going on since before the Hundred-Year War between Britain and France. They were both supported by banks that were owned by the Rothschild family. Forgive me if I'm pronouncing that wrong, but the Rothschilds are basically they are pretty much the richest family in the world. They control banks of the majority of countries. I know some exceptions would include the Soviet Union, now Russia. I believe Russia still doesn't have a Rothschild-owned bank. North Korea, Cuba, Iran, and I know there's a couple more. But long story short, when you go down this list, I think Iraq might have been on there too, but I'm not 100% sure about that. But the point being,
If you think about the first few, oh, China's on there. Definitely, I know China's on there. But if you think about them, now think about the countries that the United States has had a rivalry with in any recent sort of time. Cold War with Russia. China became communist. We had problems with them. North Korea. We were at war with them during the Korean War. All these countries have been enemies of the United States. So is it just so much of a coincidence that all these countries that we've had problems with do not have a Rothschild-owned bank? Or is there something bigger going on? Because in this, I'll say there is a lot to gain from those being blamed for the conspiracy. To say it short, they want to control the world's economy. Going back to what I was saying about the 100-year war, like I said, I'm not sure if I said this already, but they were funding both sides of the war to have both countries, Britain and France, who were the biggest empires at the time, in their debt. That's how they were funded. They were giving loans to nations and charging them interest, just the same way any bank does. But think about it. You take out a mortgage that's a loan for a house. Okay, that's something small. You're talking about a bank that loans to countries. So we're not talking a couple hundred thousand. We're not even talking a couple million. We're talking billions, if not trillions of dollars at a time. They have a lot to gain by controlling the world's economy. Hopefully I don't get myself killed for saying it, but with JFK wanting to expose what I believe is that conspiracy and basically shut down the Federal Reserve and put us back to put us into a silver standard. That's what he was going to do. He's going to put us all into a silver standard. That would mean that similar to the gold standard I mentioned earlier, except it would be backed up by silver. You could go to a bank, you could take your money, and you can give it to the bank and ask for the equal amount of silver in return. And it would have actually been printed by our country. That's the thing people have to remember. The Federal Reserve prints our money. So, not only do they control, they control everything. For long story short, for lack of better explanation, they control everything. Because at the end of the day, if you control money in this world that we live in, you control it all. So when a president of the country, which at the time had the strongest economy in the world, and we've been falling backwards for a while now, but still, we have pretty much the strongest economy in the world. Do you think they want to lose that? Of course not. So any president, because we think of our presidents as some great figures, but they're just regular people. People that are voted for. The people that we have to worry about are the ones we don't choose. We can't choose who owns the Federal Reserve. We can choose if we use it. And when someone as powerful as the president wants to stand up to a corporation like that and could lose them a significant amount of money, talking trillions, probably, at least. Yeah. they're going to want to do something about it. So, the JFK assassination, do I think there's a deeper plot behind it? Do I think anybody has gotten it 100% right of exactly what happens? No, we don't have enough information to do that. And we probably never will. But do I think it was more than what it was? Well, what it was shown to be? 100%. 100%. There was something way bigger behind this than some person independently just doing this who supposedly doesn't even have the skill to make the shot that killed JFK. Wake up, people. There's a lot more shit going on in our world than is shared to us. And trust me, people think we live in the age of technology and it's easy to find information. Well, it's also very easy to find false information. Don't believe anything you read on anything. Read multiple sources. Combine the information from multiple sides. Not just one and two. Because there's never just two sides to a situation. Nothing is that clear cut. Nothing is black and white. There's always something deeper. And there's many shades of gray. So, I'm going to give the JFK assassination, yes, that is a conspiracy that something happened that we don't know 100%, but it did not go down the way they tell us it did. And on that note, we have two left. Another yes. And one that I lost somewhere in the middle. So we're going to dive right into it. Right after I finish this beer. Sorry. All right. Thank you for that second. I'm sorry. But so for the next one, we're going to do something. I had to decide which order we're going to do this in. I think we're going to do the lighter one. And then we're going to end up off with the cream of the crop. We're going to end off with the top one. Probably the most controversial. But that I'll explain that one in a minute. Let's get through this one. This, again, a lot lighter. Bigfoot. You know I had to throw this one on there. At least to start. And if you guys want me doing more conspiracy theme episodes, I can definitely do that. That's no problem. I just decided to pick three off the top of the head that I've heard about. But there are plenty of more out there. But anyway, Bigfoot. Now, the funny thing about this is that it has evidence to it, but also a lot of evidence against it. Now, I'm going to start with the evidence against it, actually, because one of the biggest things that Bigfoot hunters held on to for a long time was this famous picture. I'm sure everybody has seen it. I forget exactly who it was taken by. I should have looked that up. My apologies. But everyone knows it. It's the one where you see him walking in a big stance in the forest. Well, the person who took that picture already came out. It was either the person that took it or the person in the costume. I think it was the person that took it. Again, I should have looked this up. I apologize. But I know basically they already confirmed that, yeah, that we planned this. We put this guy in a suit and we took a picture of him. That was like the best evidence for Bigfoot hunters that they ever had. Now, the thing against Bigfoot hunters is that once that came out as not true by the people involved in it, there really isn't much photographic evidence that is clear out there. Like, people take random pictures of something so far away, and then you try to assume what it is, but there's no real argument that it couldn't have been a bear or some other creature. If anything, but then you also go into the fact, and this is where I started to support it, then you also go into the fact that the idea of Bigfoot is not exclusively North American. In fact, the best other example would basically be their winter snow living counterpart, the Yeti. Now, where the Yeti lives is a much less populated area with much harder terrain to get through. It's near Nepal, basically, for those of you who don't know. But that area would be much easier for a creature to remain undiscovered. So, now, people might also say, oh, well, there's stories of animals like that dating back in North American folklore. But that also dates back to when North America wasn't as populated as it is now. So, again, these all could also just be sightings of back then people were using fire for light. Like, North American folklore, this is coming from before Europeans ever landed in the Americas. So, some stories get told, they get twisted over time. For example, like the story of the boogeyman. Sometimes some of these stories are just, you scare your children with them, make sure they don't do anything stupid. And in Native American tribes, wouldn't you want to make sure that your kids think that there's something they don't know out there and they don't know how to handle and that could kill them, and make sure that they're too scared to go off on their own, even if it's for a short amount of time? I mean, every parent out there wants to know their kid is all right, at least for the most part, the good parents out there. But, and then there's the big thing of, I know I'm going to butcher this pronunciation, but Gigantopithecus, please spare me if I pronounce that wrong, but this is actually a sapient related species that, according to fossil records, actually existed at the same time as Homo sapiens. Of course, this is before modern civilization for the most part. Well, not even for the most part. I mean, before modern civilization at all, and basically before any real civilization was out there taking records. But we have fossil records of their proven existence. So now, could certain pockets of them have adapted to live in more secluded areas away from the more dominant and more populated Homo sapiens species? Yes, that's definitely possible. And if they took to areas like the Himalayas, and where there's a ton of snow, would, just like the Yeti is reported, the Yeti is described very similar to Bigfoot. The biggest difference is the color of its fur. But if you live in the snow, of course, it's better for camouflage. Over time, evolution is going to, people with the ones, the Gigantopithecus is again, I know I'm butchering that, with lighter fur would have been able to hunt better, hide better, and just overall survive better. So therefore, the ones with lighter fur would have been the ones to survive more often and reproduce with each other more and keep on increasing this gene of very light, if not completely white fur. It makes it easier to survive. So, could it be? Overall, I say if you combine all the areas that this could it be, I would say that the overall theory is a possibility. In modern day, do I really think that there's Bigfoots roaming around in North America? No. No. This is a highly populated country. There are some deserted regions, but it would be very hard for them to remain so undiscovered, because we're not talking about an undiscovered creature that lives under the water or is small or anything like that. We're talking about a creature that people say is like 8 feet to 9 to 10 feet tall. It's not going to be the easiest for these things to hide. So, long story short, I'm going to give this one that middle rating of possible yet unlikely. Sorry for all you Bigfoot fanatics out there. Again, if you guys follow me on my YouTube and you have any information that I don't know, please feel free to share. I have no problem having a debate with, intellectual debate with somebody. If you're just going to come around and talk smack, you can hold your comments. Again, and is this a conspiracy that anybody had? And my biggest point, let me just put it this way. My biggest point, does anybody have anything to gain from hiding or doing anything about this? Or like purposely trying to hide this? No. No, I don't see any way anybody has anything to gain. No one is out here denying the existence of chimpanzees or gorillas or any other creature that has already been proven to share approximately around 99% of our DNA. So why would we hide this? And something so big? So the fact that there's so little evidence is what is also what leads me. The fact that there's so little evidence and yet no real reason to try to hide this is what makes me feel like this could be true in the way more rural sections of the world, but I'll call it highly unlikely. So plausible, but unlikely. And you know I had to save the best for last. Oh, you know I'm going to have to finish my last beer before I get into this one. Because this is the one that everybody, most recently, I feel, talks about. And it's happened during my lifetime. Now, let me finish my beer, and I'm going to get right into that. Let's go. Okay. Now as we get into the last one, let me take the last, I just opened this one, so not really the last chug, but a big chug of this beer, because this one gets serious. Because guess what we're going into right now? You should have known. 9/11. Now, I experienced this a lot firsthand than the majority of Americans. I live in New York City. I was in Manhattan the day this happened. I saw people trying to flee the borough, trying to get home, trying to make sure their loved ones were okay. Hell, my father worked like 2 blocks away from it. I was like in third grade or something when it happened. No, like fourth grade. Something like that. But, and my school did a horrible job explaining what was going on. Not going to shout them out, because don't send your kids to them. They have a horrible curriculum and everything else. So I'm only as smart as I am because I decided to learn things on my own. So, 9/11. Where can I even start with this? Because there's so many points that a lot of people bring up. But I think I'm just going to start with the ones that people say that there's no reason those towers should have went down based on those crashes. So first off is the failure of steel beams. Basically, it has already been proven in multiple other accords that the maximum heat that jet plane fuel can burn at was not high enough to melt steel beams. Causes a bit of problem with the whole story from the beginning, doesn't it? But moving on straight from there, because, oh, it gets way more convincing. I don't even need to break that one down too far. The failure to locate the black boxes that, for those of you who don't know, black boxes are installed on every plane crash. They are basically considered indestructible. There has never been a plane crash before that one in any history that the black box didn't survive. Now, it's one thing if you can't find the remains of the plane at all. That's a whole different story. But that's not saying that the black box was destroyed. These black boxes were supposedly never found. Now, yes, there's been some witnesses, I'll say. We don't really know everybody's credibility, so, and who's just doing it for the attention. But there's been some witnesses that have said that basically the black boxes were found and confiscated. Whether that's true or not, we have no proof on. Not either way. It's one person's word against another. That's not proof. What we do have proof on is that if all of a sudden those black boxes got destroyed in the 9/11 attacks, that would be the first time it ever happened. And as far as to my knowledge, the only time it ever happened. Now, let's get into the real dirt. What I like to call, why would someone plan this? The reason behind it. Is there a good reason for this to be falsified? For this conspiracy to be true? For anyone to lie about it? And I'm going to say, according to history and what happened afterwards, there's a lot of reasons. Now, for those of you who don't know, this relates to what we call a false flag attack. A false flag attack is when a country attacks its own citizens. A country attacks itself, basically, and makes it seem like another country or another group did it. Now, biggest thing, has this ever happened before? In American history, that can be proven. Yes, it has. We don't have a pretty past over here. And the first one that was ever actually confessed to and proven was the attack on the USS Maine in 1898. That attack is basically the largest instigator and what got support to start the Spanish-American War. We faked an attack on one of our own ships, blamed the Spanish, and then used it to invade Cuba, Puerto Rico, and I'm not sure if we invaded the Dominican Republic, but I definitely know Cuba and Puerto Rico for 100%. Either way, we used an attack that we fought, that we faked, blamed on somebody else, and then used it to go invade their country. Starting to sound a little similar? I don't know. Well, let's see. Before we get into what happened after 9/11, let's go on to the second time that we know for a fact. Again, this is a fact. That a false flag attack was offered. This one wasn't executed, but it was offered to a United States president. Now, back when JFK was president, rest in peace, JFK, probably the best president we would ever have had. He was offered by the head of the CIA at the time to attack civilians in southern Florida and disguise themselves as Cuban commandos to justify an invasion of Cuba. Now, for those of you who don't know, during this time, this was during the Cold War. Cuba had recently had a revolution. Castro had come to power. They were by default our enemy because they were supported by the Soviet Union for having what they considered at the time to be a communist government. True communism has never existed in this world, but we'll move on from there. That's a talk for a whole different time. So, during that time, JFK was offered this, and he turned it down. He refused. He didn't want to attack. He had morals. Let's put it that way. He didn't want to attack American civilians just to instigate a war that would cost more American lives and the lives of people in other countries. We, as a country, the United States, considered Cuba an enemy. But we're not at the time in any official war. It's basically what the Cold War was. It was a bunch of people were enemies, but we weren't officially at war most of the time. At least the ones really behind the scenes really weren't at war, meaning United States and the Soviet Union. We personally never attacked each other's countries. We fought proxy wars. Vietnam, Korea, there's plenty of more, but the point being, when a communist country arose so close to the United States border, a lot of people felt paranoid and scared that the Soviet Union was going to set up missiles there, which they did end up doing, and that was the whole Cuban Missile Crisis. But our president at the time was offered a chance to get validation from the public for an invasion. But it would have meant attacking our own citizens. Again, lucky JFK was a moral man for all intents and purposes. He may not have been the best husband, but hey. He cared about the public. And that, in the end of the day, isn't that what we really want from our public servants? Because that's what all politicians are. We give them the power. They're not an emperor. They're voted in. The public gives them the power. They're supposed to serve us. And JFK may have been one of the only ones to really ready to do it right. It's probably why he was killed. But I already talked about that. Now going on to what happened after the 9/11 attacks. And why does this all sound very fucking similar? It's because first we were targeting a terrorist organization, Al-Qaeda. Who, by the way, their so-called leader, Osama bin Laden, even though he was supposedly killed, we actually have no evidence of that because nobody ever saw a body. He wasn't taken to trial. He wasn't taken back to the United States. We sent an elite squad of Navy SEALs in. And they weren't against a ragtag group in a surprise attack. But we couldn't, and then the body they said they had, they threw it overboard. Now, I can't be the only American out here that wonders himself, but you couldn't have taken a picture or something. You couldn't have brought it back. You couldn't have done anything to confirm that you guys actually got the right guy. Because Osama bin Laden, even if they think they got the right guy, there's plenty of cases of people with doubles. Basically, bodyguards that are made to look like them and represent them and do what they're told to do by whatever leader they are. But they're given plastic surgery and other things to make themselves look more like the person they're trying to protect. So if push comes to shove and they get killed, people might not realize at the moment, or in this case ever really, that they weren't the actual man that was targeted. And guess who else did that and was very... I have no proof that Osama bin Laden did that. But guess who lived around the same area? And we know for a fact that did that. Saddam Hussein. Leader of the next country we tried to pin 9/11 on and then go and invade. Basically, we tried to say they had ties to Al-Qaeda. That was not true. If anything, Saddam Hussein hated Al-Qaeda. He was not one to share power. He was a ruthless dictator, and yes, he deserved to die. I'm not arguing that. But in the end of the day, he would never have let Al-Qaeda have a foothold in his country and try to have any sort of power in his country because of how narcissistic he was. And yes, he had many bodyguards that basically he put them through plastic surgery, and their job was to show up at public events and other things, and just in case anything happens, well, it was you, not really me, so I'm still here. That was his mentality, very narcissistic. We get that a lot these days, I guess. But we said they were included with Al-Qaeda. We said that they had weapons of mass destruction. United Nations investigators went in. They were allowed in. They checked. They said, oh, no, they don't have any weapons of mass destruction. What do the United States do? Oh, we don't believe you. So screw the United Nations. We're going to do this anyway. Really? Doesn't that sound very similar to the end results of the first false flag attack and the desired results of the second proposed false flag attack. So yeah, 9/11. There are a lot of problems with the story of what happened. Oh, I can go on for days, but I'm not going to. I'm sure everybody has their own opinion this time. And if what I've said already hasn't already started to make you think, nothing I say will. So I'm not going to waste my breath. All I'm going to finish this with saying is, was there a reason? Yes, a huge one. And we ended up in a war. A war that we had no reason fighting. And a lot of Americans died in that attack. And fast forward, now about 18 years later, the whole thing has been swept under the rug because people have refused to open their eyes. Unfortunately, that happens a lot in this world. There was a lot to be gained, again, from that attack. And that's the biggest calling card to any false information and any idea that someone may have been behind it that we don't know, is if that person had something to gain, something police look into their investigations, who could have had something to gain from this person's death or these people's death? What was the motivation? And trust me, things on this scale, they don't happen without motivation. Anyway, on that note, I told you guys I was saving the best and the most serious for last. If you guys don't agree with me, please follow me on YouTube. Look up my videos on YouTube for anybody listening on anything else, so you can leave me a comment. Please follow, subscribe, like, whatever platform you're on. And without further ado, I'm sorry, I just want to end it off on such a solemn note. I'll try to make the next one a little lighter. The official, and for those of you on all of the platforms, the official episode 2 was actually supposed to be a lot lighter. But due to technical issues and recordings getting lost, it ended up being a YouTube exclusive. So please go ahead, follow me on YouTube, Hungover Hermit, episode 1.5. Check that out. That was my most lightest episode. I got drunk. I had a good time. You could see me getting drunk the whole time. I had fun at that one. This one was way more serious than that. But I don't want to waste no more time. This is yours truly, the Hungover Hermit. Cheers, everybody. Let's get out of here.